feels really good to be back on this lake because it is a beautiful place to be. The scenery is absolutely spectacular. And the first time I was here was in 2006 when I was here with Steve Briggs. And nothing seems to have changed, it's just stunning. Now, the swim that I've got, I've not actually chosen myself. I've had to go on a bit of local knowledge here because the guys at Morocco Carp are on the lake regularly. They know the spots, they know where the fish are coming from. And they've put me in this area where, I don't know the name of it, but they tell me that there's been fish out to sort of 15 kilos or so in the last few days. So I'm pretty happy that there's carp going to be around here. And there seems to be an awful lot of water as well. There's a lot of options available to me. So what I'm going to do is spread the rods about. I'm going to start off with a rod round to the left here in this bay, one straight out in front of me, and one round to the right as well. And on a lake like this, because it's me first trip for many years, what I'm going to do is just stagger the rods at different distances and different depths as well, because last time I was here in 2006, although it was a long time ago, I do remember distinctly that we had to find the right depth of where the fish were. So there's no good putting all your eggs in one basket and fishing all at 20 metres or 10 metres or 5 metres or whatever. So I'm going to just try and stagger them about. But the one piece of information that's been really good to me is that at the moment I know that the water level's up and it's going up roughly about half a metre a day. And on these big lakes like this, when the water level's coming up, in my experience generally the fish start to come into the margin. So I'm going to probably start off quite shallow, put the rods in only 2 or 3 metres of depth, and you know, sort of stagger them down to maybe 3 or 4 metres of depth. So just try and find where those fish are. And I do know as well that there's quite a lot of litlins in here at the minute. The fish have spawned really well, so I want to try and escape those. So I'm probably not going to put too much bait out either. It's just going to be a little bit here and there, a few scatterings around each hook bait. So that's where we're going to start. And I've got 10 days in front of me, so it's a long time to change things and try different options, but it's good to be here. So let's see where we get from here. I'm almost ready to rock. I've got my rods all kitted out, and I brought with me the 10-foot Exodus rods. Now these are only 40 odd quid in shops, which is fantastic price really for what they are. They're 10 foot in size, so they're perfect for traveling. And I've got these loaded up with the 12,000 ACR reels. I've got a 15 pound mono on those, and they're straight through to a braided leader. And on the end, I've just got a lead clip and a 4-ounce lead. All I've got left to do is to tie the rigs up, tie them on, and get them out there. On the business end, what I've got is around about 15 inches or so of hook link. Now today I'm using the captive coated hook link, and I've just taken all of the outer coating off, and then I've tied it knotless knot style to a size 2 hook. I've then got a liner liner on there, which is formed with a bit of shrink tubing. And then on the hair, just to try and avoid those smaller fish, I've gone with 2 20mm bottom baits and then a corker just on the end of that to just keep it up off the deck. This kind of presentation is known as a stack rig because basically you've got a stack of baits on there. You've got the 2 20mm and then the corker on the end. And the idea is that when a small fish come into the swim and they start pecking away at the baits, they can only get those top 2 baits into their mouth. They'll keep going, they'll keep gorging, you will catch the odd smaller one, but the idea is that the baits are just left there, and when a big one comes into the swim, it hoovers it up and it goes straight into its mouth. Now, one of the good things about using small rods like 9-foot or 10-foot is that they always fit perfectly in the boat. I've used 12s and 13s on the likes of Rainbow Lake, and when you've got that 2 or 3 foot of the rod tip just hanging over the end of the boat, it just gets in the way. But these ones, they fit perfectly. Got a bit of a saying about these big waters, and it's whatever you see on the bank is what you see in the water. So if you start seeing rocky outcrop, then the chances are that's what's going to be below the water. Same with areas like over there. If you start seeing very rounded off areas and very smooth bits of land,
then the chances are it's going to be a bit like that under the water as well. So wherever I tend to see stones and rocky outcrop and things like that, I always think, yeah, that's where the food's going to be, because on waters like this, the fish are going to be feeding on crays and large crustaceans, which tend to always congregate around those rocky areas. So that's what I'm going to be looking for on the echo sounder, those kind of spots.
I've got the local dogs to keep me company. Hello, darling, you alright? There's about half a dozen or so of them, and apparently this one, she's had two little puppies, and here's two of them. They're really shy, those two are. And apparently she had four puppies, but two of them are gone. Hello, darling. Just got a nice tongue in the face there. Hello, little'un. Come here, you two little'uns. They're really shy, these two are. These two little'uns. Hello, fuss pants. Look at him. These are wild dogs from Morocco. They just want a bit of fuss, like all dogs do. Come here, little'un. Come here. Hello. All right, all right, all right. And there's a shepherd over there, and he's got on the far bank, and he's got his own dogs, and they've just come around to this point here, and the dogs that have been in my swim just barked them all off, so they're really territorial. I presume one or two of the anglers have been giving them a bit of bait, but you know, these. Come here, little one. Come here. Sorry, that's the one with the two puppies. She had four apparently. Two of them have gone. Don't know where they've gone, but. There's loads of wild creatures knocking about, so I'm sure that one or two of them have been lost, unfortunately. Come here, Mum. Let's see how hungry they are then. Let me get my shadow out of the picture. And I've got some meat here, some sausages. Do you want some sausages, dear? Is that what you want, some fresh meat? Hang on then, let me open the packet. Let me open the packet. Hang on a minute. I'm not going to have all of you just jumping into it. It's going to be one each, alright? Hang on, hang on, hang on. One for you, darling. Wait a second, one for the big one. There you go. Little puppies, puppies. There you go, hang on a minute, hang on a minute. Your turn next, your turn next. There you go. Wait a sec, wait a sec, wait a sec. Oh. These boys are gagging for it. Mommy sat there waiting.
Get off.
When I got here yesterday, I decided to mark where the water level was at with a couple of bank sticks, and that's the one that's on the right hand side of the swim, and I've also got one on the left hand side, and I was told that the water level was coming up at about half a metre a day, but clearly, as you can see there, it's been dropping. Now, I started off fishing quite shallow, because in my experience of these big waters is when the water level starts to come up, the fish start to come into the margins, but clearly they've not been coming into the margins in this area because I've not caught anything so far. I've been fishing between a metre and 3 metres in depth, and this morning when I got up I did start seeing quite a few fish at range, showing between sort of 150 to 200 metres. Now I know out there it's probably about 8 to 12 metres in depth, so what I'm going to do now is reel all three of the rods in and get them out there a little bit further out, probably stagger them between 8 to 12 metres, probably put one rod in 8 metres, another one in 10 metres, another one in 12. Now it's just a case of trying to find where these fish are at, what sort of depth they're at. When I came in here in 2006 with Steve Briggs, we had rods spread all across the swim at a variety of different depths, and I distinctly remember we could only catch them from one depth, so it is a case of trying to find out where they're at today. You know, if you sit still on these big waters and just wait for them, you can be weeks and weeks and weeks away from fish. And obviously, I've got a few days ahead of me. I've got 9 days left in front of me, but I want to try and find these fish as quickly as I can. So I'm going to get out in the boat and have a look and see what I can find out there.
Look at that. Fish of about a pound in size, with three massive boilies coming out of his mouth. Yee. One of the future stock. Come here, little thing. Just gonna unhook him and let him go. Come here. There you go. My first fish. I've not blanked. Tiny little baby.
Day two, and it's a little bit milder today than it was yesterday. It's still a lot warmer than it is back in England, because at the moment it's probably about 17 degrees, something like that. I think it starts to peak at about 18 degrees today, but it is going to get a lot warmer tomorrow and as we near the weekend. So where we're at the moment is that I'm getting plagued by the small fish. It's a little bit of an annoying thing, but I do know that out there are some better fish. You know, you've got to play the waiting game on these big waters. I've started getting a lot of messages off my mates from back home saying, how are you getting on and what you're catching, and then wanting to know why I'm not catching the big ones and stuff like that. And it reminds me a little bit of what I used to be like when I first started fishing on these big waters, because 20 years ago, I was very impatient. I was a completely different carp angler to what I'm like nowadays. And I remember going on the likes of Cassian and Reduta and being really impatient and wanting to catch fish straight from the off. But someone like Steve Briggs, who I fished with quite a lot in those days, taught me some invaluable lessons, which really is you've just got to sit and wait. You've got to be very patient on these kind of waters. You know, it's I don't know how many thousand acres this lake is, but to just turn up here and drop on the fish straight away, it doesn't always happen like that. When we first fished this lake in 2006, the fish were a lot more naive than they are now, so it was a case of just finding them and casting out and catching them. But since then, they've been pressured quite a lot. There's a lot of areas on this lake that they can move to and escape anglers' lines, and so it is a case of just sitting and waiting and hoping that they will turn up. We've got quite a lot of a few days ahead of us, so Anthony's due in a few days' time, so I'll evaluate things as we get to sort of that stage. If we don't catch anything of any sort of substantial size by then I might decide to move swim. But, you know, there's a long way till then, and it is a case of just sitting and waiting and hoping that one of these big ones turns up. And I'm sure they will do. I'm sure they're out there. You know, it is a numbers game trying to keep off those little fish. But I've switched over to tigers now, and that's definitely slowed them down. So we'll see how we get on. Oh, there's this little dog at the back there, you can just see him. He's desperate to come down. I think he wants to come and get some food. But the little dogs that I've got here in the swim keep chasing him off. And he's very timid. Just another one of the many wild dogs that are out here. It's crazy, a local guy came into my swim yesterday and I don't know what he wanted, because he couldn't speak English or French. He was chucking bricks at the dogs and I had to stop him from doing it. You know, but that's just the way of life over here. You know, there are dog lovers out here, I can assure you that. They're not all anti-dogs, because one of them had a little collar on, but there's so many of them, I think, that they just become a bit of a nuisance to a lot of the locals. But I wish I could take them all home, though. And I certainly know that my girlfriend Lucy back home would be absolutely desperate for me to take them all home. Take a look at that. This is one of the nuisance things that you get from having small carp or a nuisance bream, etc., in the swim. I mean, we've got fish at the moment of about a pound, 2 pound, regularly taking the baits. And I've had two 20 mils and an 18 mil hook bait on there. And somehow one of them has managed to tie it into a knot. And I've tried to unpick it and I just can't do it. So I'm going to have to re-rig this rod. Yep, bit of a nuisance, but next bite might be that one that we're after. There's always something that happens on these trips whenever I go overseas, and the latest story is that, yep, one of these dogs, that little one down there, who's fast asleep at the moment, has bit me about an hour or so ago. It was completely, I wouldn't say accidental, but It was my own fault because he was scrapping with one of the other ones and I tried to split him up and he's grabbed hold of my wrist and broken the skin. And I just mentioned it to the guys at Morocco Carp and they've said to me, yep, you've got to go down to the local hospital and get an injection for rabies. So, because they are wild dogs, they don't know anything about them. And it's always better to be safe than sorry. And recently, I think one of the British tourists over here got bitten by a cat and he died. So, yeah, definitely worth getting checked out. But he's fast asleep at the moment, the culprit is. And I don't think he's got rabies, but it's definitely better to be safe than sorry. Well, I know everybody else is sat at home freezing at the moment, because I've just been looking on Instagram and there's loads of shots of icy cold setups and white over bivvies. But here, it's 26 degrees. I might only be catching little fish at the moment, but I know there's big ones out there. And I'm just about to tuck into my dinner and watch the sun go down on a beautiful place. It really is a fantastic lake to fish, this place. Really, really special, got its own uniqueness about it. What a lovely evening. Day four then, and the old beard growth's coming on nicely. A little bit of growth there, which makes up for the lack of eyebrows. Yep, you might have noticed that since the last blog that I did, there's something a little bit different about me, and it's because I had a bit of a mishap with a pair of clippers. My missus and my kids are always telling me that I've got mega bushy eyebrows, so I thought I'd do something about it, and got the clippers on them, and yes, you've guessed it, there was a bit of a problem with the clippers, and I ended up basically shaving off one of my eyebrows as I was doing it, so I ended up having to level them out and have two eyebrows that were virtually just non-existent. So thankfully they started to grow back a little bit. Yep, anyway, back to the fishing. Yeah, it's still been mega slow, so what I'm going to do today is I'm going to have a little bit of a mooch about in the boat. The guys from the camp are coming over to see me today and we're going to go and have a look around the lake and see if we can find some fish, because all I'm catching here is tiddlers. I'm sure there's one or two better fish out there, but I just can't get amongst them. And as I said, the last time that I was down here with Steve a few years back, I distinctly remember that we had to get on the fish, we had to get on the showing fish, you know, where they were lumping out. So, you know, I've basically come on this trip and just been put in this swim, and I'm not happy here, so I need to get on the move and go and try and find some fish, because what's happening tomorrow is Anthony Molyneux from Avid, he's coming over to do some filming with me, and the plan for this particular session was for me to get out here and find some fish before Ant gets out here and we can do some proper filming for Avid Adventures. So yeah, having not caught anything of any size, it's not going to look like an Avid Adventures much if I can't get on some better fish. So that's what I'm going to do today. I'm just about to start packing up and the lads are going to come over and get me and we're going to have a little mooch around the lake and see if we can find some better fish. It's amazing to see the amount of bubbles that are coming up off the bottom out there, and apparently it's the old riverbed just gassing up. It's not fish, it's just the lake bed turning over. Absolutely incredible to see. There's just bubbles everywhere. Right, I've spent close to 3 hours now looking around the lake in the main boat with the lads, and we've gone from one end of the lake to the other, and I must say it's been a hard decision deciding where to fish. But in the end, I've opted for an area known as Quince's, which is a completely different terrain to where I was. I've 6 nights left in this swim, and there's loads of water to play with, so fingers crossed it comes good in the end. Good morning from the new swim, and you join me on what is set to be a glorious day. The sun's just come up, and temperatures are set to reach about 25 degrees today, so it looks like being a really interesting day. And I must say, it was heartbreaking leaving that other swim yesterday, because those dogs are desperate to follow me around the lake, and they was that desperate that they ended up jumping in the lake and swimming behind the boat, which was horrible to watch. But, you know, sometimes these are the things that you have to do. Now, this swim that we're in now, it looks really, really interesting because there's some really nice features out in front and there's loads of scope and potential. But unfortunately, it's at this point on my channel when we have to say farewell to me in Morocco, because the rest of this trip is going to be filmed on the Avid channel as part of Avid Adventures Part 6.